Good afternoon from the annual meeting in San Diego. We're pleased to be here today with Dr. Bruno Trinidadi. Thank you, Bruno, for being with us today.
Well, thank you, Jonathan. It's a pleasure being here.
I'd like to speak with you this afternoon about your expertise regarding the pinhole intraocular lens implant. You have several wonderful papers at this session, including one that's award-winning. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
Can you please start us off by describing the pinhole implant and how exactly does it work?
Yeah, sure. So we've been working with this implant for the past 5-6 years now. It is an implant that was designed to be implanted in the ciliary sulcus of pseudophakic eyes. It is made of a black foldable hydrophobic acrylic that you can insert it into a clear cornea incision, your regular clear cataract incision, 2.2 millimeter incision. And it is supposedly mostly indicated for people who have irregular corneal astigmatism. Mm-hmm. That's not the only indication. We can also apply this same technology for people who have pseudophakic presbyopia, but in our opinion, the best indication for this technology is for patients who have irregular corneal astigmatism.
So Bruno, when you say irregular astigmatism, can you give us some examples of what you mean by that? Is this from corneal scar, from corneal injury, from corneal dystrophy? What is the usual?
So we've published our initial series of patients who've been having irregular astigmatism due to several different conditions. But the main conditions are keratoconus, post-penetrating grafts, mm-hmm. Post-RK patients, and also some trauma patients with mm-hmm. corneal scars and corneal irregular abnormalities, basically.
So I know that one of the very important papers that you're presenting at this meeting is about the pinhole implant in keratoconus, in corneal ectasias. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Sure. You know, Jonathan, that these keratoconic patients, they some of them, not all of them, but some of them are in deep trouble, right? Because they keep fighting, they don't get good spectacle-corrected vision, they rely on contact lens fitting, which are, for some of them, not ideal. In terms of working, some of them have some working limitations, labor limitations. So these patients, some of them, they're suffering, jumping from one doctor to another, trying to find someone with a solution that could find that could give them some sort of visual mm-hmm. independence. So these patients are the ones that are most needing a solution. Mm-hmm. And giving you a little bit of background, there has been studies showing the importance of a refractive lens exchange in keratoconus for correcting the spherical and the cylindrical error that keratoconus produces. And we have also demonstrated the importance of the intraocular pinhole in minimizing the impact of irregular corneal astigmatism in such patients. So we thought, why not combining those two technologies and offering these patients, these specific patients who are in deep need, a solution. So we would do the refractive lens exchange and then implant also the intraocular pinhole on mm-hmm. top of the intraocular lens.
So that's a great point. So we may be talking about younger patients with keratoconus who are not pseudophakic, and so in order for the pinhole technology to work, you need to render them pseudophakic by performing a refractive lens exchange. Are those procedures done at the same time, meaning are you performing the refractive lens exchange with IOL implantation in the bag as well as the pinhole implant in the sulcus during the same procedure, or is that a staged process?
Yeah, so normally we do on the same sitting, so mm-hmm. same procedure, one procedure, we do both. And it is also important to highlight that these patients, they often have a high refractive error that is mostly induced by the steep cornea. So these mm-hmm. patients are often highly myopic. So another benefit of combining the implantation of pinhole with the refractive lens exchange is that we can get rid of the myopia and with all this big refractive error mm-hmm. that they usually have with the refractive lens exchange as well.
Well, Bruno, this may be a silly question, but if you're providing, if you're planning to provide a pinhole implant in the ciliary sulcus, is that patient's intraocular lens in the capsular bag, would that patient be a candidate for, let's say, a toric lens implant or a presbyopia correcting lens implant? Or since you're planning the pinhole implant, would you prefer a more straightforward monofocal implant in the bag?
That's absolutely not a silly question. It's mm-hmm. actually one of our papers actually addressed that, and we went in details into the benefits specifically of a toric intraocular lens in that setting. Mm-hmm. So it is important to think about the toricity, because sometimes in some patients as astigmatism correction is also an adjunct treatment in these patients, and they can benefit a lot. Mm-hmm. So it is very important to think about the toric IOL. I don't think it's not so much important about the presbyopia correcting IOLs. First, because we're using small aperture implant anyway, mm-hmm. and second, because these patients, they do have a multifocal cornea, which provides mm-hmm. them some sort of depth increase. Mm-hmm.
So I have a couple questions about sure. the pinhole implant specifically. If the patient is not satisfied with the visual outcome, is this something that you could then subsequently explant if the patient wishes to have the pinhole removed from their visual system?
Yeah, sure. So this pinhole is designed to be implanted in the ciliary sulcus, mm-hmm. so it is very easily removable. Mm-hmm. Of course, you can't put the original lens back.
Yes.
The crystalline lens back, but the pinhole itself can be mm-hmm. easily explanted. And one point I would like to mention is that obviously this procedure it doesn't come without some sort of risks. So we need to weigh in the risks very carefully. And probably the most important risk that we need to think about, especially in these young patients in whom we're planning on replacing the crystalline lens, is probably retinal detachment. Mm-hmm. So these patients, they need to have a full retinal exam prior to that mm-hmm. surgery. And even then, these patients need to be monitored, and they need to understand that this procedure also carries some risks. But again, these are patients that are in trouble, mm-hmm. and they're probably the alternative that they have is a corneal graft, which also doesn't come without mm-hmm. a whole bunch of risks as well.
Understood. If the patient still has residual refractive error after the refractive lens exchange and the pinhole implant, is that patient then a candidate for spectacles or contact lenses
absolutely.
In the presence of the
absolutely.
Pinhole?
Absolutely, yeah. absolutely. We're talking here about patients who can't see well basically without anything, right? So spectacles are definitely on the table for these patients. Mm-hmm. They're very willing to wear them if obviously they provide an adequate vision, mm-hmm. which in most cases is what they get after this procedure. So we can tune up their vision after the procedure with some spectacles, definitely.
Well, Bruno, this has been a fantastic discussion for us this afternoon about applications of the pinhole intraocular lens implant. Thank you so much for sharing your expertise with us today. Congratulations on your award, and thank you to our audience at home for supporting us as well.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me.